is it we are here on this path we walk? In this world of pointless fear, filled with empty talk. Descending from the egg, the scientists please all think. Will they save us in the end? We're trembling on the brink. Men's mighty flying machines digging in the ground, stealing rare minerals where they can be found. Concrete caves with iron doors bury it again, while a starving, frightened world fills the sea with grain.
Excellent. And I think the very first thing we're going to do, as a matter of record, is admit Pat.
There you go.
There you go. It's as easy as that. Evening, Pat. Oh, switch your thing on.
Yeah. You're on mute.
Good evening.
Good evening. Good evening, Jill. Good evening, Pat. I'm going to ask you to...
Pat's muted.
She is. I'm asking her to unmute.
Mm-hmm. There we go.
There she is.
Hey.
Good evening, Pat. How are you doing?
Yeah.
Hi.
Right. Good. Well, as I was explaining to the early risers, Father Ross is running this evening the first session of the rebrand, which is called Father
Building Faith.
Building Faith, splendid, and it's got a really top logo. I don't know if you've seen it. If you haven't, you're going to see a lot of it. So, because, you know, logos are, in fact, the only thing that matter.
Yes, Stuart.
Everything else is, you know, is niff-naff and trivia. Robin, who is at the moment nonchalantly sitting on his sofa, in the next 10 minutes is going to sort of depart for another country, because he and I have got another meeting with the Deanery Shaping for Mission process. And I think I can speak confidently for both of us, Robin, when I say we would both far rather be here.
Yes.
however, what's going to happen is that he and I will dip out. The thing is running through my computer, so it will just stay on. Father Ross, do you need to share a screen at any point?
No, I'll be okay.
Right. Is there anything else you need in terms of the settings that I need to adjust?
Not what I can think of. I think we're good to go.
All right. In that case, over to you, brother.
And, thank you.
And Robin and I will just mizzle off at the appropriate point.
Yeah, we'll just hope. Well, I'll hope it's not because it's boring. But
yeah.
Brilliant. So welcome everyone to this relaunch of our sessions over Zoom. We all collectively decided that after our Zoom towards Christmas over the Advent season, we all wanted to gather again together on Tuesday evenings. And so it's wonderful to see all of your faces again. And hopefully this will run every Tuesday going forward. And so we'll be exploring different themes, different topics. Like the Advent course, we'll be having different people leading these sessions as well. But for our first session, given that it's a relaunch and we're in a new year, we are going to look at the theme of New Year, Same Fears. So I'm first going to start off with a passage from Scripture, Psalm 13, verse 1. How much longer will you forget me, Yahweh? Forever? How much longer will you hide your face from me? If we look back at the ancient works by Homer in the Iliad, it tells the story of the king who angered the gods through his arrogance. The response: Apollo caused a plague to erupt among the Greek army besieged in Troy. In our current age, we do not need recourse to mythical stories about the gods to explain an outbreak of a novel coronavirus named COVID-19. We understand that diseases, epidemics, and occasionally pandemics are not exceptional in human history. Nonetheless, especially in the case for a once-in-a-century outbreak, at least in this part of the world, we are shocked. Apart from the enormous disruption at the macro level to industry, commerce, trade, transport, and so on, with knock-on consequences for global and national economies and employment, there are the personal and communal effects. The realities of illness, death, and bereavement is present for many. We think of the surreal sight of funerals with few mourners. We think about people in hospitals who are selflessly working. We look at checkouts and supermarkets, on public transport, or on our streets collected and empty in our bins. There has been the reality of confinement. The not being able to come and go as we like, restrictions on meeting loved ones, the inability to plan. Empty streets are replete with an eerie silence, albeit the clear sound of birdsong, our sense of life suspended. And now, as a new strain of the virus is present, we are still taking tentative steps towards a return to life before COVID with the introduction of new vaccines. There has been, however, a certain wariness about this, and also a wariness as to how we feel about one another. Many people too, even in this age, have, like our forebears, addressed the human need to seek for a deeper meaning in this crisis. Sooner or later, this trial of inquiry leads to talk of simplicity and meaning, and then of love, and then inevitably, religious question arises. Supposing God exists, what role does God have in all of this? On the sidelines, like the deist God of the Enlightenment, or present and engaged, then why so seemingly ineffective? Is God all powerful? Does the answer change if we focus instead on the idea that God is all loving? A global pandemic may be particularly bewildering for us because we live in a secular age where, as one commentator noted, we inhabit an imminent frame of reference, which leaves us poorly equipped at a public level to discuss issues of ultimate meaning. We have, to a large extent, lost our literacy about religious matters. As a society, we are church illiterate. I was surprised during my undergraduate and the theology cohort came together, made up of 70 students. When we was asked to recite the Lord's Prayer, I was the only one who could do it. Others either knew it in half or not at all. We as a society have become very church illiterate. But before I upset myself on all of these things, I want to ask a question of all of you. What has the last 12 months looked like for you? No one wants to go first.
I'll go first.
Father? Oh no! No. Sorry,
go on then. Father. Who's that? Carry on, Tom.
It's that nuisance from Gamesfield Green, Paul and Roy. Oh hello! We had such a game getting in. I do apologise if I'm sort
that
of
wasn't the question.
Talking. I know the question that you've asked. I'll get to it. Depressing is the answer, if I'm going to be totally truthful. Very depressing, and punctuated by moments of joy when we come to Mass and when we pray, possibly not nearly enough, but that's straight from the horse's mouth, Father Ross.
That's very honest. I think for a lot of us, it has been very depressive, very difficult. I mean, do others have similar experiences which they would like to share?
My husband, I think you met him, Father Ross, was in hospital for the whole of April with COVID. He suffers from asthma under normal circumstances, but he caught the virus. We don't know how, because we were being very careful. And he was told when he went in that they wouldn't be jumping on his chest to revive him. He was to make his peace. And he rang me and he said, "We've had a good life, haven't we?" And I said, "Pardon?" And he said, "We've had a good life, haven't we?" I said, "What do you mean?" He said, "Well, I might not survive." And I sort of, this was 31st, about the 1st of April. And I was absolutely, shall we say, gobsmacked. Because when he went in, okay, he was very poorly, but he was still with us. 3 weeks later, he came home, having survived. And 3 days after that, he went back in with heart failure. And again, they told him that he wouldn't, they wouldn't jump on his chest. And when he came home the second time, he couldn't walk. He came home with two do not resuscitate forms, one from the first time and one from the second time. Shall we say that over last year, I think I have been sorely tested. I have really survived, and so has he, albeit he's not as well as he has as he was before, and he's going through lung function tests and all sorts now. But I mean, Dawn's had the similar experience, haven't you, Dawn?
I think for me, it's been it showed me how important face-to-face and physical contact is. Supporting the carers who have been in every single day working through the pandemic, some of them really young girls who've got families at home, putting their lives at risk, just need a hug, doing funeral visits over a telephone or on a Zoom. It's not the same. I've never done so many funerals. Actually, after taking the funeral, just the simple thing of shaking somebody's hand. You can't do that. You can't comfort people. I think for me, when I had COVID, it taught me this. The only person I could rely on was God. The medics had no words for me. Nobody had any people could help me and offer advice, but the only person that was actually there with me through it and was a very, I felt his presence, was God. And it was God that got me through. It was. So it taught me actually that when you are rock bottom, you can still rely on him and he'll still be there. And that's what it that's what this year has taught me.
You probably wouldn't expect me to quote from that august theological author, Barbara Taylor Bradford. But I'm going to, because there is a final line in the book concerning Emma Hart, which I remember reading as a teenager. And the summary of this life was in one sentence when her granddaughter asked her what in the end was the meaning of it all. And it wasn't a religious take by any stretch of the imagination. She simply said, "The point of it all is to endure." And I think that's been my recollection since last March. I started the year ill over Lent and Easter, and as did Fiona and Patrick. And certainly nothing to compare with what John had to put up with. But nevertheless, it was, I think our mortality was visited upon us. We realised just how phenomenally close we are to this thing. And I think the last week or so, with the climbing R rate and everything else, and the realisation actually that we're dealing with something we have no comprehension of, actually, is just very, very salutary. And it makes us re-examine our attitude to living and dying, our attitude to one another, our attitude to God. I mean, if this doesn't actually cause a revival, then we're not in showbiz. Because we're forced to focus on the very kind of precepts that we have shaped our lives around. And this is the acid test. This is the moment when that all gets put into the crucible, if you will. And we'll see how shiny it comes out. There's one of those great lines from this morning's Psalms, which Father Ross read for us. Silver from the furnace, seven times refined. And I think we're being refined, but it ain't very pleasant. And that's, you know, we got to take it seriously.
With that, would you say there is a sense of fear going into this new year?
Yeah.
Anxiety, for sure.
Mm. Yeah.
Yeah.
To go back to what Dawn was saying, the only person she could rely on was God. I remember Father Roger, I don't know how long ago, a few years ago, you said in one of your sermons, when you are at the end of your tether, God is at the other end. I'm sure you remember saying that. I think you said it a couple of times. And I've never, ever forgotten that. And that has kept me going to some extent throughout this difficult time. When you're at the end of your tether, is that right, Dawn? God is at the other end.
I like that.
Yes, I must say that's not my words. It's the words I heard when I was a choir boy sitting there during a long, dreary sermon. And the bowls of wisdom came. And the other thing he said, bless him, was an elderly priest with a massive wisdom. He said, remember that Our Lady's always with us and she's always praying for us as we ask for her prayers every day when we say Hail Mary, full of grace. But it's simple things like that, I must say, help me through things. I think that the other thing to say is that when we're at the end of our tether, remember that God is at the other end.
Good evening.
Hey.
How are you doing?
I'm all right. It's a long day.
Yes.
Started about 12 hours ago.
Yeah, exactly.
Feels like already.
Yeah. I'm currently monitoring another Zoom meeting. We've got a parish catechesis thing going on my mainframe. So you're on my phone.
Okay.
So I'll just make sure I'm...
You're not muted, Father, no.
He is now, but the joys of going live. That never work with children, animal or clergy.
I think that fear, what you were saying about fear, I think every new year we always say, oh, this new year can't be as bad as the last one. But with this pandemic, last year we never thought this year could be any worse, but how we've started it is actually worse than last year, isn't it? And I mean, I know my fellow workers in the home and across MHI, we've already lost 20 residents and 2 staff across the West Midlands since Christmas. And we're frightened. We're frightened, you know, and the hospital staff must be even worse. We're frightened. And so you start in the year in fear of what is to come. You know, it's and as the chaplain, you've got to be the one with the smile on your face and bring in the hope. And it's hard.
It's the fear of the unknown, isn't it?
Yeah.
Fear of the unknown.
Yeah.
I use the word bewilderment because I am bewildered by everything. It is just absolutely unknown. And I don't know how many times I've argued with Dawn over the phone about, well, what should I do? What should I do? Shall I do this? Shall I do that? I'm always the person that's got an answer and a plaster.
Not always, Gillian. Not always.
And this time, I have to say, I'm bewildered. I don't know.
There's no answer.
Please yourself, because there is no answer. You have just got to try and keep yourself safe. We are so insecure. People are so confused by every rule and regulation there is. You have to do what you think is safe for you. Not what's safe for anybody else, what's safe for you. And I'm no different to those at the hospital. You know, my husband has just gone to work now on ITU. They have 22 ventilated patients. And the aim is that they have double that amount. And I just went, where from? Where are you going to get the staff from?
Yeah.
You know, the staff have only got one pair of hands.
Yeah.
And it is unbelievable. I just can't believe it. I've just said, as he's gone through the door, stay safe. I'll have a bacon butty for you in the morning when you come in. And he said, I will, I'll try to be as safe as I possibly can. And literally, he comes through the front door, his clothes go into a bag, straight into the washing machine, and there for the grace of God. But we have to all stay as safe as we possibly can. And that might mean that we're bored and fed up of the same four walls around us. But if any of you want to call me during the day, I've got plenty of time on my hands. You can all have my phone number and I'll welcome a chat with you.
That's what keeps us going.
Absolutely.
The communication, even if we can't do it face to face.
Yeah.
We can talk to somebody, and that's the most important thing.
Absolutely. Yeah. I've been on a Zoom this afternoon with Parish Nurse Ministries UK, the trustees of the charity. And I mentioned this tonight, and I mentioned people from the churches, and all of the trustees sat there and prayed for every one of you. And that was just lovely.
There's that wave of prayer which we all need at this time.
Yeah.
Thank you for all of your contributions. Then if you can all see in the chat, Father Damien, you look like you are having more fun than we are. We definitely are. Talking of fun and celebration, then, we would usually have had a lot of fun very recently. We have recently celebrated Christmas. And it is at Christmas that for us, we get who God really is revealed in Jesus Christ. Far from being distant and uninvolved, Jesus shows that God is with us. Is literally the title given to him in the Christmas stories recorded in the Gospels. Emmanuel, God with us. The Christian claim is that God takes on human form, the incarnation, Jesus. He is like us in all things but sin. Jesus is in solidarity with us through suffering. He presents the mercy of God to us in bodily form. And crucially, he is the one who dies through a slow suffocation on the cross. The events of Good Friday take on a new meaning as we are haunted by this virus. His family and friends were denied the chance to grieve as well. The authorities intervening in the disposal of his corpse. The women who discovered the empty tomb were, after all, engaged in a foray to try to honor his body in the culturally appropriate fashion. Where else have we seen Christ in the midst of suffering? Well, throughout the course of history post the resurrection, I can point to an altarpiece, the Eisenheim altarpiece, painted by Grunewald in the early 1500s. It was created for the monastery of St. Anthony in Eisenheim. Antonite hospices such as this one concentrated on the care of patients with skin diseases. The altarpiece depicts Christ's crucifixion as others around him, such as his mother Mary, are overcome with grief. The altarpiece portrays Jesus as having the same skin diseases as the sick who came to the hospitals to receive care. The skin riddled with blemishes. His fingers are grotesquely curled. On the ground, witnesses to his death are anguished. And many of the people who first saw this altarpiece easily relate to it on an individual level, as they would have known someone who had fallen ill with the same disease. Myself, a few years ago, I went to Poland visit the concentration camps of Auschwitz. And in Auschwitz I, inside the prison, and the idea that a concentration camp had a prison is a thought which still baffles me to this day. Engraved with fingernails was someone's depiction of Christ holding out his heart of mercy. We see Christ in places of suffering. And this virus demands a theological reflection, and we have to grapple with all the pain. In this time of worldwide sickness, Christians pray to God who understands and has experienced affliction we are seeing today with this virus. I want to ask all of you, do you see God in the suffering?
I would think it is in the suffering. Perhaps we see God closer than ever. The great, that sounds odd, but one of the great privileges of ministry is to be with a person as their life is ending.
Yeah, I was doing funeral arrangements for the family earlier on today, and even in the immediacy of grief, there is that confidence within the family who are typically unchurched, who seem to have found a source of comfort in the fact that there may be something beyond and presence with us today. They can't really articulate, almost paraphrasing what they said down the phone. But it is in those times of great stress and anxiety, we look at the book of Job, for example, when everything was going wrong, near to death's door, he still praised God. He still saw God. Does anyone else have anything else to share?
I think for me, obviously working with dementia care residents, it's really hard for the families. they every day saying goodbye to a piece of somebody they love. And more often than not, when it comes to the end of that person's life, they see it as a blessing because it's such a cruel, cruel disease. And then when we do the funeral visits and we're sitting talking for the eulogy about the things that that person's done, it's like that person comes back alive to them because the dementia takes over that for the families and it takes away the person that they were. And although it's sad that you have lost somebody, for me, one of the best parts of my job is listening to that person's life and writing the eulogy and making it a tribute of who they are. You know, every time I lead a service there, it's unbelievable. People that can't even articulate a sentence are joining in the Lord's Prayer, are singing hymns, are quiet when you're reading the Bible stories. God is still at work in them. It's amazing to see, absolutely amazing. God's there in the suffering. You know, and I always think of that verse that I will be your God until your hair is white with age. And God is, you know, he's there through all of it. And those moments of clarity, you can't put a price on it. You can't put a price on it. It's amazing.
Well, to pick up on what you said, Dawn, my husband, Dave, as several of you here know, had dementia for, well, best part of a decade, really. He died 3.5 years ago, and about 3 days, I think it was, before, as it turned out, 3 days before Dave died, he was in end-of-life care in New Cross Hospital because he'd got pneumonia as well as the dementia. And Father Damien said, I'll come to the hospital and visit him and I will anoint him. And I'd got just the one son in the room with me at the time. And if ever God was in a room, God was in that room then. Father Damien was very gentle and he spoke very quietly to Dave. Dave didn't appear as if he was with it at all, but you don't know, of course, do you? No. You know that, Dawn. You know that you never know what they can understand and what they can't. And he sort of told Dave what he was going to do and, you know, touched his hands and so on and so forth. And we received communion. And all I can say really is that, and I'm going to get emotional in a minute, so I'll shut up. If ever God was in room, God was in that room on that Thursday morning at New Cross Hospital. That's all I can say at the moment, folks.
We have had, can you hear me, or am I still on mute?
Yes.
You?
Can you hear me? No, we can hear you.
We've had a wonderful thing happen at Christmas. One of our presents was Alid Jones's latest CD called Blessings. And some of the narration accompanies him with Dame Judy Dench. And it's quite a delight when you find out that she's an absolute Christian, which really moved us. And it's he sings, "Then shall my heart keep singing," and it was just a great joy to us. And I keep going back to it because it fills me with joy whenever we play it. And so it just gets you through what inevitably is going to be a very gloomy time. And that was just a little experience that we had that I'd share with you.
Thank you for sharing.
My neighbour of 30 years had dementia and died just before Christmas. And the funeral was a humanist funeral the only thing that was a Christian part of it was everybody said the Lord's Prayer, that moment was such a moment of peace. You could feel it. There were very few people, only the two families and John and I and another cousin of Megan's. The moment of peace was the Lord's Prayer. And after we'd finished saying it, everything just went really quiet and gentle is the way I can put it. It just felt right. The funeral service to me didn't feel right, but the saying of the Lord's Prayer, it was so gentle. And she hadn't known anybody for a very long time, but they'd nursed her at home and she'd never been away. And the feeling, as Dawn said, of relief for the family. But she came to life in that funeral service by saying what she'd done in the past and how she'd been and what the things were that she, when she was born and what school she went to. And she came back alive to me, whereas she hadn't been alive to me for quite a long time. And that was an extraordinarily moving moment.
There's a sense of mystery which cannot be explained.
Mm. Agreed.
Yeah. I want to run with that theme a bit more in the sense that sense of mystery which we cannot explain runs deep in all of our faith. It runs through our Christian faith, Christian witness. Any attempt to make sense of death and resurrection, stretching from Mark and Paul in the New Testament up to the present day, it's a mystery which we're still trying to get our heads around, more so when we talk about Christ. I want to talk about a Swiss Catholic theologian, which some of you may know, called Hans Urs von Balthasar. But before I move on to him, I want to share some words from Dr. Sanji Pereira, who is a cognitive psychologist and research fellow in the University of Birmingham, who talks about her lived experiences of the Sri Lankan Civil War, her experiences of death and destruction all around her, and how the pandemic has reawakened such trauma. So to quote, "And now as we awake in this olive grove, and death stalks us like a night's terrifying energy, we are in the midst of Gethsemane, bracing ourselves for a tidal wave of death. Death, who we have only seen as the periphery of our vision before, suffering that was only an abstract concept of a far-off continent before, is now being measured and projected and analysed every hour on the hour on our TV screens to a frozen and captive audience. Death like we have never imagined before in our lifetime. Anguish and insecurity that all the strategies of economic systems and social policy, constructivism and resilience management can never ever redeem us from. All my years of investment in cognitive catalyst models, trauma theory and developmental psychology seem insufficient now. Only a wounded healer can intervene, console, redeem. Only a broken body mangled by death can speak to our anguish." That term, wounded healer, it's an oxymoron. And it was a term coined by Balthasar. The Christian conception of this experience is counterintuitive because it insists that humanity reaches glorious perfection, not in a figure who had amassed great power, but in one who emptied himself of his divine status, become not just human, but our servant, and to the point of accepting death on a cross on our behalf. The cross is a torture device deployed by a military superpower to oppress and terrorize colonized people. But in the hands of the early Christians, it became a symbol of self-sacrificial, non-violent, human solidarity. And so Balthasar argues, we are captivated by the beauty of Jesus because he is the icon of God's love, which is not self-serving, but other-focused. In this light, we come to see that love wins, but the victory is costly and it takes time. Despite then the seemingly intractable nature of our difficulties in this life, and those in particular of this present period, the constant refrain of the Christian scriptures is, do not be afraid. That message is so important that it appears 365 times in scripture, one for every day of the year. And so despite outward appearances, we are told that blessed are those who mourn, for it is when I am weak that I am strong. The New Testament and the life of Jesus himself reveals a God who wants us to have life and have it to the full, both individually and collectively, but to do so while being in solidarity with one another and in relationship with God. And so I pose the question, how will we find that strength to be in relationship with one another and with God in these present circumstances?
Can I say something, Father?
Of course, Father.
It will be brief. I think the thing that it's so easy to forget, and that is that God is with us all the time, through the good times and the sad times and all those things in between. And the one thing we don't do as regularly as we ought is to think during the day, where has God really been with me during this day? And it's amazing how, by just asking that question for yourself, you become more conscious that he is with us all the time. And it's a simple thing to do. Just ask yourself to reflect. So I think the one thing that separates Christians from a lot of people who might be hangers-on in some way, whose faith is very weak, is that we should be aware of God with us.
Detected at the front door.
Sorry, I finished.
All I heard was God with us at the end, what you said, and then something is at the front door, and God is with us even at the front door.
I'd like to say, Father Ross, I think communication is key, isn't it? Whether we're communicating with God in our prayers or with each other, and not, you know, on situations like this, the people's testimonies and sharing their lives and everything, that helps us build our relationships with each other, and that knowledge that we're all there and able to listen and empathize and just love each other, really, to so we've got that group support to get through the tough times, you know, from God and from each other.
But we never do the Christian journey alone. Yeah.
The support I had from everyone when John was in hospital and I couldn't visit, and I was just sitting thinking, you know, well, thinking thoughts that perhaps I shouldn't have done, was absolutely, well, it was impossible to say, because it was such a support, and the number of people who rang Are you fed up having phone calls? I know I am never fed up having phone calls. And it really, it did support me. It got me through. And it got me through the worst times. And they were bad. And I've never been so grateful to people just picking up the phone and giving me a ring. It made a wonder of a difference. And still does.
When I was really poorly last March, at the same time as Dawn, the pair of us had COVID together. Not that she gave it me, it was Simon that gave it me. Can't hear you, Dawn. I literally had a bottle of holy water from Lourdes on the bedside table. And I used to lie in bed with the blankets round, just looking at the holy water. And this is, you're going to think I'm stupid now. Well, maybe I am, I don't know. But have you ever read the words of the Beatles song, "When I Find Myself in Trouble"?
Yeah.
"Mother Mary comes to me." Well, yeah. Read those words, because those words mean an awful lot to me.
I think I've got the original 45 of that one.
Have you? Yeah, it's lovely. And in all honesty, I said about the bewilderment. We are all bewildered. Oh, I'm going to get upset. This is twice this week. This is not me, is it? I got upset yesterday on the leadership team. But you have to let it be. It will be what it will be. Yeah. And those words in the song are absolutely spot on. They really are. There's nothing you can do. We've got to ride it out. It's got to stay its course. It'll be here till whenever. I think it'll still be here come the end of the year. In fact, I wouldn't be surprised if we're still talking about it this time next year, because it will mutate and change. So there isn't anything we can do. We've just got to hang on in there, be safe, and let it be. Let it ride its course. And those words from the Beatles, just Google them and have a look, because they are lovely words. I don't know who wrote that for them, but...
Most of us that are quite old, Jill, we don't need to Google them, do we, Verity?
No.
Shall we sing them?
The Beatles ever sung.
No, Jill.
I mean, it could be raining or snowing again.
Yes. Yes. Singing on Zoom is not a good idea. We've tried it with the guides and it doesn't work. It's awful.
But you say, Jill, there's nothing you can do. My oldest friend, and we are very old, she lives in Australia now. She's been there 25, 26 years, but we still have a natter. And she goes to her church. She's the Betty Foreman, if ever anybody remembers Betty, of her church. She's the catering lady. And she said, she was talking to me the other week, and she said she'd gone to visit an old lady who was ill and so forth. And she looked at my friend Marge and said, "There's nothing I can do." And Marge looked straight back at her and said, "There is one thing you can do." And I think everybody that I'm looking at here on this screen knows what that one thing is. She says, while you're sitting there, you can pray.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah?
Mm. Yeah.
Yeah.
I think I've said enough. I think somebody else ought to say something now.
I feel like that too.
Yeah, well, we'll shut up then, Verity.
Chatterbox extraordinaire, I think, is...
Come on.
Yes.
But you're right, prayer is at the heart of everything we should be doing. Is the way we communicate, but one of the ways in which we communicate with God. And whilst we are currently deprived of the sacraments, with all of our churches currently suspending public worship, it is one of those ways which we can still speak with God, to know him and allow his love to be revealed even more deeply to us. And then that easily translates to how we treat the fact that we've once again gathered over the platform known as Zoom, to continue on encouraging each other, to hear each other's stories, our testimonies, to delve deeper into difficult and challenging subjects is really a work of mercy. And it's something I am extremely grateful and thankful that I'm a part of. And I'm confident that this is not going to be lost once we can come back together physically. I think there are, for years I have said that social media has made us far less sociable beings. I think I've had to eat my words this year, because for the first time I've ever seen it, social media has made us more connected than ever in a very conscious, dynamic and directed way. I don't know if others agree with that.
Oh, definitely. I think I said at one of the very first meetings prior to Christmas that it's been a lifeline. It has its detriments. I mean, there's so much negative thinking on Facebook and things, but it has its good sides, and this is one of them.
I mean, certainly earlier today, it's our granddaughter's 10th birthday today, and obviously we haven't seen her since way before Christmas, but we could, as a family, we could all gather together at tea time, you know, and she had her birthday cake. We did attempt to sing Happy Birthday, but I agree it was a disaster. but we were all connected, probably more so because of you know, having six children, so it's a large family. We wouldn't normally all be together for Zoe's birthday, but we were, and it was important to everyone that they were there, and that was lovely.
Well, I said I wasn't going to say anything else, but I will. I chose to spend Christmas alone, because this was before Boris told us that we hadn't got to go anywhere, because I didn't want to go to my son's because of the likelihood of infection. And, oh, you can't stay at home, this, that and the other. And he sent the dog, Father Ross knows my Lola, sent the dog to spend Christmas with me, which was fabulous. But I have to say, I enjoyed my Christmas thanks to technology. I spent a lot of time on Zoom and on FaceTime with all branches of the family. I've got three sons and they've got two children each, six grandchildren. And I spent such a lot of time on, as I say, FaceTime and Zoom, that Christmas went by in a flash. It was absolutely fabulous. So I think at the moment it's a good substitute for being together. It saves making beds and cooking meals.
And you didn't have to do the potatoes,
no, quite. But, you know, quite seriously, like we all are here now, I think it's fabulous.
Yeah.
You know, you think of in the war, when the women didn't know, it was mainly the women who were at home, didn't know whether their loved ones were dead or alive, basically. And, you know, here we all are, and all our families, and we're able to speak to each other. And use Zoom, as we're using it tonight, you know, as a means of talking about our faith. So I think it's wonderful.
I can't imagine anyone who lives alone who has no faith.
Going no faith, did you say, Beryl?
Faith.
Yeah.
But no belief. Mm. Going through this time. I've got two children. Both live away from the area. And anybody who knows me knows that we've always been very close. But I haven't seen them since the year Christmas gone.
Yeah.
And all sorts of celebrations come round, don't they?
Yeah.
So yeah, I find that my daughter, I've got a grandson whose birthday this week. I've got a daughter who's 50 in February. I've got a grandson who's 21 in March. Now, those would never have passed by without me seeing them or without me spending time with them. But you asked how people felt in the first place. And the overriding feeling for me is lonely.
Yeah.
Extremely lonely. But I can't imagine a person in my position, and let's face it, there are thousands of us, but I can't imagine anybody living like what I am now with no faith. I can't imagine how they get through a day. How do they do it? Because I couldn't. I just could not. Technology, it's got its place. It certainly has got its place. And it's been a godsend.
Most definitely.
There is no substitute.
Mm.
I don't know how people do it. I can't imagine.
There's no substitute to face-to-face, but it's a substitute, but not one that we'd want under normal circumstances. But it is a stopgap, and it does keep us in touch.
But if people have got no faith, they don't feel anyone is beside them at all, they don't feel they've got any guidance, they don't feel they've got anyone on their shoulder.
No.
It just seems... I can't imagine it.
Mm.
And that must be so lonely.
Yeah.
I think that's a very good point for us to really conclude on. Our journey of faith, we've talked about this earlier, we never do it alone. We have people who support us. And in the midst of all of that, God is always with us. And here we might begin to notice that divine love which remains in the midst of our suffering and our emotion, and our joy and our loneliness and our sorrow, in our rejoicing. We are out of the Christmas season, and before we know it, Easter's going to be around the corner. We have once heard that we might all be able to be together for Easter, which, who knows? Who knows what might happen? But let's live in that hope anyway, because yes, we are fearful, but we shouldn't lose sight of hope. And maybe if we all can, together for Easter, we might start to imagine what a future could emerge like in the light of the resurrection, and how we pray for a resurrection at the end of all of it. I want to thank you all for joining me for this first session of Building Faith. Unsure what we're going to talk about next week, but we'll gather next week and we might have a different person leading. I might be leading again. Who knows? Might be given the sack for this. All I do know is that we are going to join together again next week, same time, and we'll have a lot of fun together. And I want to thank you all again for sharing your own stories. This is going to go up on YouTube. And if for those of you who are watching on YouTube want to contribute to anything which has been discussed, then please leave your comments in the comment section below. Like, subscribe, all of that. we need those numbers.
Perhaps not.
but for us for now, I'm going to close with the grace, and I'll let you all enjoy the rest of your evening. So let us pray. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, evermore. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Father, one and all.
Thank you, Father.
And
sorry
see
for
you
my
all
technical difficulties.
Next. Pardon?
Starving, frightened world fills the sea with grain. How is it we are here? How is it we are here?